Educational Communications and this station present Environmental Directions with Nancy Perlman. On this series, we explore the effects of human influence on the Earth's ecosystems and discuss solutions to environmental problems which affect the quality of life on this planet. Environmental Directions gives you the kind of information you need to help you participate in decisions impacting your community, the nation, and the world. Now, here's your host, Nancy Perlman.
Hello. For the next half hour, we're going to be talking about the Anza-Borrego region of Southern California with my guest, Dr. Mike Wells. He is the former district superintendent of the Colorado Desert District for the California State Parks. His 34-year career with the California State Parks had him working as a ranger, a resource ecologist, as well as being the former state park ranger at Anza-Borrego Desert State Park. He is a former lecturer in the Department of Biology at the University of San Diego, and he is co-author of A Natural History of the Anza-Borrego Region, Then and Now. Welcome. It's a pleasure to have you with us.
Well, thank you, Nancy. It's a pleasure to be here.
Your book is a superb introduction, not just to the Southwest Desert of California, but to deserts in general. It was fascinating to learn about the deserts of the world, how the climate affects them, the geology, the process, the geologic history, and the specific physical geography of this region. Let's begin with Anza-Borrego. It is the second largest state park in the continental United States after the New York Adirondacks, but it's probably the largest if you don't count all the inholdings. Where is it? How big is it? Tell me more about it.
Okay, Anza-Borrego Desert State Park is in southeastern California and sort of makes up the eastern 20% of San Diego County. It's, as you said, a very large park. It's about 640,000 acres, which roughly comes out to about 1,000 square miles. And so it's roughly about 70 miles north and south and 35 miles east and west. So it's a big area.
You describe what a desert is, and it has to do with the amount of precipitation, but they're not all the same. They're not all sandy dunes.
No, in fact, that's a fairly rare type of desert. Maybe find it in the northern Sahara and a few other places in the world, but most deserts are defined by the fact that we get more insolation, meaning more sunshine, than we get precipitation, meaning that the power of the sun is greater than that required to evaporate all the precipitation that we get within an area.
And you describe the impact of the mountains and how they affect the rainfall, or lack thereof.
In Southern California, most of our precipitation comes from the Pacific Ocean to the west and to the north. And Anza-Borrego is sort of in this little corner, well, I won't say little, a big corner between the Peninsular Mountains to our west and the Transverse Mountains to our north. And so we are in kind of a double rain shadow. So those mountains block precipitation coming from both the west and the north. And so we're a very dry area.
You have stunning photographs, including one with a double rainbow, but you also have beautiful pictures of some of the geology, the various rocks that shape the desert, and they're not all the same. People might, driving through quickly, think, oh, it's just open space with a few cactus, but that's not the case.
No, and again, people tend to have this mental concept of what deserts are, and really they're extremely diverse areas. In Anza-Borrego, we have mountains that go over 7,000 feet high, and we have areas that are more than 200 feet below sea level. So there's a tremendous range in elevation, and with that range in elevation, we have different habitat types and different vegetation. We have everything from yellow pines in the high mountains down to alkali sinks that have very little vegetation at all at the lowest elevations.
What surprised me when I first read the book was that it wasn't a guidebook to what trail to take and what plant or animal you might be seeing, but a book that described how this whole region was created. And you go back to many, many millions of years to describe the shift and how the continents were once connected. What is the theory there?
As we go back in time, and as you're saying, several millions of years, actually most of the land masses of the Earth were joined in one central mass, and then a little bit later into two masses. And over time, those through what we call continental drift or tectonic movement have separated and split apart. And so Anza-Borrego originally was part of the bottom of the Pacific Ocean, and then it was elevated, and then about 3 to 6 million years ago, it was flooded again and became part of what we would now consider a northern extension of the Gulf of California. It has, through time, the environment itself has changed completely, and the geological record is the record of those different environments that have existed in that place over time.
You talk about how the Colorado River and the other water bodies have shifted and changed, and about an ancient Kewalla Lake, very similar to the Salton Sea?
Right, ancient Lake Kewalla. You know, over time, the Colorado River is what we call an exotic river, meaning that the water comes from someplace else. And in the case of the Colorado River, it's the Rocky Mountains. And over time, as the river has flowed, and it's mainly a seasonal river because snow falls in the Rocky Mountains and it melts in the springtime, and we get a big influx of water that comes down the river basin. And along with it, it takes a lot of sediment. The river flows, and then when the spring flood stops, all the sediment that was in it gets dropped. And so that course of the river may be filled up. And so over time, the river course itself shifts as it's filled up with sediment. And so it wanders back to the east and back to the west. And for a time, it flowed into what we call the Salton Trough, which is the basin that's now occupied by the Salton Sea. And so at least three times since the end of the last ice age, we've had large freshwater lakes as big as some of the Great Lakes that filled that basin. And we find the geological evidence of that in the eastern part of Anza-Borrego Desert State Park.
But now, in your geology section, you have pictures of some places with some very strange names. The Borrego Badlands, the Elephant Knees, the Coquina, the Mudballs, Dunes, Alluvial Fans. What's the difference?
Well, they're all things that are the result of geological processes over time. And things like the Badlands are just areas that are highly eroded, meaning that they have the material that makes them up is easily moved by water. And so over time, those areas have become networks of little sort of the beds of streams and creeks and rivers. And so it's highly eroded. Elephant Knees are areas, and you mentioned the word coquina. I said that about 3 to 6 million years ago, a good portion of Anza-Borrego was occupied by a northern extension of the Gulf of California. And during that time, the water level changed. If you think we've gone through several periods of ice ages when the sea level in the world changed. It fluctuated by as much as 300 feet. When Anza-Borrego was at the bottom of the Gulf of California, and it was between about 30 to 60 feet in depth, oyster shell reefs formed. Then as the water changed and got deeper, more sediment would go on top of those. And then over time, after the end of the ice ages, the water receded. Those areas were exposed. And as water erodes down through it, it encounters those areas of compressed oyster shell, which is called coquina, and they become prominences in the landscape, meaning areas that stick out because they're more resistant to erosion than the other sediments that are around them.
What I very much love about desert is the open expanse. At night, you can see the sky. In the daytime, the clouds. And you describe the various basic types of clouds, cumulus, cirrus, stratus, nimbus. You can see them all down there?
Yes, you can. And in fact, my favorite type of cloud is called lenticular cloud, and that comes because they are lens-shaped. And they're caused by rising masses of air. Say, as a mass of air moves and encounters a mountain ridge, it'll be deflected upward. And as it goes upwards, it gets cooler. And if it gets cold enough, the moisture in the air mass will condense and form a cloud. And because lenticular clouds are in masses of moving air, they form like a lens shape, something like a lentil. And you can see these over the mountains in Anza-Borrego, and they're quite beautiful and quite spectacular.
The early Indians, Native Americans that lived in the area, actually had sites that marked the solstice, the summer solstice, the longest day of the year, winter solstice, the shortest day. They marked these in the rocks with pictographs and petroglyphs. What other kind of artifacts have been found from these early inhabitants?
There are several different periods of Indian occupation in the Anza-Borrego region, and some of the very oldest ones are marked by what are actually probably incorrectly called sleeping circles, which are rings of stones that are between the size of, say, a bowling ball or a basketball, and then all the stones inside the center of the circle have been removed to form a smooth surface. And so these are probably areas where people worked and maybe slept. Those are probably the oldest features that we have in the park. And then from more recent inhabitants, one thing that we commonly find through areas throughout the park are what we call waste flakes. When Native Americans made tools, and they were very ingenious in doing this, they would chip them. And then one of the favorite rocks that they used was obsidian. And there's actually no obsidian, native obsidian, within Anza-Borrego Desert State Park. Most of what we have comes from an area close to the Salton Sea, Obsidian Butte. And it was imported into Anza-Borrego and used. So you can, in various places around the park, you can find these deposits of waste flakes. Those are areas where people actually sat down and made tools. And then also we have, as you said, pictographs and petroglyphs. And petroglyphs are actually etchings that are made in rock. And in the desert, a lot of the rocks that have not been moved for a long time form what we call desert varnish, which is a deposit of oxides of iron and manganese. And they form sort of this dark red color that's very common in Anza-Borrego. And the Native Americans would etch through, would chip through to make pictures. And so those are found in various places in the park. And then also we have pictographs, which are paintings on the rock, usually made of pigments. The most common ones are red, yellow, and black, and then to a lesser degree some blue in some places. But those are usually found in sheltered places like little caves or alcoves. And those are the types of pictures that are used to mark petroglyphs. And there's one, they're used to mark solstices. In the south end of the park, there's a place in a canyon where there's a cave, and it has lots of pictographs in it. And on the day of the summer solstice, as the sun rises, it shines through a little aperture in the rock, a little opening, and it shines on a pictograph in the back of the cave that's the shape of the human being. Archaeologists think that this is something that Native Americans used to tell themselves, you know, when summer was coming, which is a pretty important thing to know out in the desert.
In your book, A Natural History of the Anza-Borrego Region, Then and Now, you also present the fact that there's a new theory about the Native Americans crossing over from Asia, when they came down and how they came down.
Right. You and I probably learned in school the theory of when human beings first entered North America was coming across a land bridge across the Bering Strait and then entering the rest of North America and eventually South America. The archaeological record has improved and been expanded. We found that's not really consistent with the evidence. Actually, the oldest sites in the New World in North and South America are actually in South America. They're about 16,000 years old and maybe even older than that. And they're found close to the coast. And so the new theory is that people probably entered the New World by following the coastline. That if you think about it, coastal areas are very rich in resources. You have edible seaweeds, you have invertebrates like abalone and other animals that are scallops and clams, and then also fish and marine mammals. And so it's a fairly easy area for people to get food. And so people probably migrated going up the coast of northern Asia and then following it across into Alaska and then down the coast and to South America. Then probably entering South America, entering the terrestrial areas, the land areas, to hunt large animals that were common then in the New World, and then eventually dispersing northward. And that's consistent with the current archaeological record that has the oldest sites in South America and then the actually oldest sites in North America being in Texas and Mexico and then spreading northward from there.
You've presented so much fascinating scientific information, but in a very readable, easy to understand way for the average person to get a better grasp on the incredible landscape and flora and fauna. And we're going to talk more with Dr. Mike Wells when we return in a moment, especially about the animals and plants in the Anza-Borrego region.
Environmental Directions with Nancy Perlman continues with further discussion of the world's critical ecological issues. For more information, you may call 310-559-9160 or go to www.ecoprojects.org. Now, here's Nancy.
I'm speaking with Dr. Mike Wells. He is a former district superintendent of the Colorado Desert District for the California State Parks, has been a park ranger, resource ecologist. He is a member of the board of directors of the Anza-Borrego Foundation and has received numerous awards for his work. We've been talking about geology, geography. What fascinated me were all the different kinds of plants and animals that existed, still exist, the interrelationships between these, from mammals to birds to invertebrates, how they interact. One of the things that most people might not be aware of is that horses and camels actually evolved here in North America, went across the Bering Strait, and had to be reintroduced to North America. Why do you think they went extinct?
Well, you know, that's a good question, and it's consistent with two, I think, very important factors. And this period of extinction happened in North and South America at the end of the last ice age, about 12 to 8,000 years ago. A couple important things happened. One is that with large mammals, they tend to like cooler, more northern areas. And so during that time, the climate in North America and South America became much warmer and drier. And so the areas that were suitable habitat for those large mammals sort of shrank. The other thing that happened is that human beings entered the New World. And so we know that some of the earliest people that we know in North America, a culture that we call Clovis, were large animal hunters, that the projectile points that are found in their sites are actually very large. Archaeologists have found the remains of large mammals that show signs of being butchered and killed. The thing that really kind of blows me away is that elephants were once very common in what is now the Anza-Borrego Desert. They've found over 200 sites that have the physical remains of animals related to modern elephants, such as gompatheres, mammoths, and mastodons.
It is very interesting to discover what was there, but let's talk about some of the animals that are there and how they adapt to the desert environment, because you describe in detail how they go across a hot desert sand and how some have developed a hopping technique. And you've compared animals such as the black-tailed jackrabbit with the Arctic hare and how one has bigger ears, one has smaller appendages. You show that the kinds of foot that lizards have might make a difference in terms of their getting across these hot places in the summertime, and how the movement can range from hopping to like a sidewinder snake that moves by alternating pushing down and lifting up, just doesn't push around.
Actually, that's a good point, because one of the things that distinguish deserts is, you know, we don't have a lot of vegetation there because of the lack of rainfall. And so a lot of the surface of the ground is open and uncovered. And so there's loose material there. And so if you're trying to move across loose material and you're pushing sideways or backwards, a lot of your energy is going to be converted into moving material. You're just going to push stuff away rather than move. And so animals in the desert have evolved different ways of actually, when they move, pushing down rather than pushing back. You mentioned sidewinders, that movement of the snake pushing down with one coil while reaching forward with another is a good way of moving. That way the energy is transferred down, not sideways. Animals that hop, when you think about hopping, a lot of the force of their feet is going downward and to propel them up and forward. And then also you mentioned lizards, and some of the lizards that we have in the desert have fringe toes, fringe-toed lizard, which makes their foot like a little, like you can think of it sort of like a snowshoe. It expands the area of it. And so again, so it's pushing down and not backwards and moving the lizard forward.
So often in naming animals and plants, they have been named for something that they look like, but not even related to the family they are. And I didn't realize that the kangaroo rat is not a rat.
No, it's not a rat. It is a rodent. So they are related, but not very closely, actually. The kangaroo rats are some of the animals that are most specifically adapted for desert environment in that they move by hopping. They also store fat in their tails, and they're able to produce what we call metabolic water. which means by converting fat to energy, they also produce water. And so kangaroo rats actually drink very little water. And also they're burrowers, meaning that they live underground, and they're actually able to reabsorb water that they expel through their breath. They also store dry food in their burrows, and that dry food absorbs some of the moisture from exhalation, and then when they eat the food, they recover that moisture.
The plants, of course, also have evolved so that they don't have big leaves that need rain and water. They store some of the water, such as the barrel cactus.
A lot of desert plants are succulents, meaning they have relatively thick skins and either small or no leaves at all. And so that allows them to store water. And then also, most of the water that plants lose is lost through evaporation from their leaves, through the pores in their leaves. So desert plants tend to have very small leaves, and also the pores tend to be on the bottom side of their leaves. And some plants, like the cactus, have no leaves at all, and some, like the ocotillo, only have leaves immediately after they've absorbed moisture and then lose them as soon as the air gets drier.
I thoroughly enjoyed your chapter of the interrelationships between plants and animals, especially the birds and the bees, shall we say, literally the native bees, and how the insects and the plants have evolved so that one is dependent on the pollination of another, and the pollination is different depending on the insect and the plant. It's incredible, the drawings that you have in your book, the natural history of the Anza-Borrego region then and now, the pictures that you have. I thoroughly enjoyed seeing the little chicks in a cactus, and you explained that they do that because it protects them from predators.
They do. The cactus wren nests in cactus, and so it's very difficult for predators, which are usually larger than the bird, to get in there and get to their nests. And so there's a lot of what we call coevolution, meaning that animals over time have evolved and influenced the evolution of other animals. And probably the best example of that is insects and flowering plants. That flowers exist on plants to, number one, so that insects are attracted to them so that they can pollinate the plant, but also the insect harvests nectar. And so the insect gets a meal and the plant gets pollinated. And so it aids in the plant's reproduction and it gives a free meal to the insect.
And you also describe the concept of mimicry, how some species copy another species to protect itself.
Yes, there are a couple examples of that. In Arizona, there's a snake called the coral snake, and then there are other snakes that are non-poisonous. The coral snake's very poisonous, very dangerous, but there are snakes that mimic its color pattern and are mistaken for it. And so those snakes are protected by this mimicry, by looking like something else that's dangerous. Also, that's the case with, if you think of butterflies, the monarch butterfly, which has a very distinctive orange and black pattern, is a poisonous insect to most birds, and so birds don't eat it. But there's another species of butterfly called the viceroy that has a very similar color pattern to the monarch, and when they both occur in the same area, very few of the viceroy butterflies are eaten because they look so much like the poisonous monarch, and the viceroys themselves are not poisonous.
Your descriptions of the various animals and plants and how they have adapted to each other, to the environment, is just marvelous to read. Of course, we want to go out and we want to see this beautiful area. 20% of San Diego County is the Anza-Borrego State Park. Yet, we think often of parks as a protected area, but you do describe some of the current threats, whether or not it's developments of human freeways or buildings going near them, or even the renewable energy systems, the wind farms and the solar farms that do threaten some of the wildlife. These areas always need our attention, don't they?
They do, and every generation faces new environmental threats as technology evolves and as our civilization changes. In eastern San Diego County, there are lots of good sites for solar energy and wind energy because there's lots of wind and sunshine there. But you have to get that energy from those places to the places where people are, which are mainly out at the coast. And a park like Anza-Borrego, which is 70 miles north to south. To get the energy, you need to cross the park. And so things like power lines and energy pipelines have been proposed for the park several times in the past. And up till now, we've been very fortunate in that the public has been very good about helping to defend the park. And so those projects have been deflected either to the north or south of the park.
The references that you have for the factual information is extensive. You lived and worked in the area. You showed people what the area was. You worked on resource management. What did you find to be the most unusual discovery in doing your research and your work? And what did you find people were most surprised about when they came to the Anza-Borrego Desert State Park?
The thing that probably surprised me most was the park paleontologists showed me the fossil footprint of a gompatheer, which is an animal that's ancestral to elephants. Footsteps believed to be about a little more than 2.5 million years old. In the same area, there's also the fossil footprint of a dog-like animal and a cat-like animal. So someday, 2.5 million years ago, those three animals stepped in a puddle of mud and left their impressions. That still exists today. The most fun that I have in the park is just going out and exploring areas, because you find little surprises like that all over the place.
You are co-author of this book with Marie Simovich, who for over 31 years taught population biology, conservation biology, and desert biology at the University of San Diego. And you also have Diolinda Monteiro providing infographics, and Ann Kowalski providing illustrations. You used some beautiful photographs that you were able to obtain over the decades. That's an extensive collaboration.
The book was a real team effort. We all did different things. My role was to write the text, but it was written from the lecture notes, and I should say Marie Simovich is my wife. We co-taught the class Desert Biology at University of San Diego for 16 years, and so we had 16 years of lecture notes that formed the basis of the book. By training, I'm a physical geographer, so things about climate, weather, geography, geology were all the things that I lectured about, and my wife lectured about the biology and ecology. Also, I just wanted to say the publishers of the book are Sunbelt Publication in San Diego. As a publisher, they specialize in the natural and cultural history of San Diego County.
Most people think of deserts as having just cactus, but you describe other plants. And of course, in the springtime, the best time to go out is to see the wildflowers that bloom. But you can go to the washes and see the various trees and bushes. There's a lot more there, isn't there?
There is. And again, people have these sort of stereotypical images of what the desert is, and it couldn't be farther from the truth. The desert is a very rich and diverse place, and there are lots of different types of plants and animals there. And depending on what habitats you choose to look at, you're going to find different things. If you want to visit Anza-Borrego, do so, but don't just visit the common places that tourists are kind of funneled to. Go up in the mountains. Go out to the alkali washes and dry lakes. Go up on the rocky hillsides, and you'll see a very different desert every time you go to a different habitat.
What does Anza-Borrego mean?
Anza comes from Juan Bautista de Anza, who is the first Spanish explorer to pass through this area. And Borrego is the Spanish name for ram, and it comes from the desert bighorn sheep that also are found in the desert.
Thank you so very much for loving the park, for sharing it with us, both in your 34 years of career with the California State Parks as superintendent of the Colorado Desert Region, as a ranger, a resource ecologist with the Anza-Borrego Desert State Park. And thank you for sharing all your wonderful information and love of the park in your book, A Natural History of the Anza-Borrego Region, Then and Now. Thank you for being my guest.
Well, Nancy, thank you very much, and thank you for all the work that you've done in helping to protect the environment and natural areas.
Thank you. And I do want to mention that all proceeds from the book go to the nonprofit organization Anza-Borrego Foundation. I have been speaking with Dr. Mike Wells, who has been a state park ranger and superintendent with the California State Park System. I'm Nancy Perlman. Thank you very much for joining us, and do tune in again next week.
If you would like free information about these environmental issues, go to www.ecoprojects.org or call 310-308-8867. 859-9160. Environmental Directions with your host, Nancy Perlman, is a community affairs program of the nonprofit organization Educational Communications and this station.